Boy, song just takes your breath away, doesn't it? I'm going to be in Romans 8, and I'm going to be all over the place, actually, so just bear with me. Romans 8, 4 gives us an exhortation to walk in the Spirit. And I don't know about you, but I had that down pat. I just walk in the Spirit like that. Moment I get up, the moment I go to bed, I'm just walking in the Spirit. I'm just me and Jesus, just walking in the Spirit. Now, I get up and I'm pretty good about walking in the Spirit because no one else is up yet. But then other people get up and life happens and the phone rings and the text comes in and the people don't know how to drive. I'm the only one who knows how to drive in Pinellas County. And all of a sudden I find myself not walking in the Spirit momentarily or for a few hours. Or longer. But there we are, exhorted to walk in the Spirit. Or how about this verse? You all quoted it. It's a wonderful verse, and it's true. I am crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. See, I have no problems because I live in faith to the God who loved me and died and gave himself for me. See, and that's positionally absolutely true. How about Galatians 5:16 when it says, I walk in the Spirit so I don't gratify the desires of the flesh. See, here's the problem. We're exhorted to and we're encouraged to and we're told we can walk in the Spirit, but sometimes in my life I feel like there's maybe a legion inside of me trying to hack its way through the jungle of my flesh. So, this is going to be sort of a practical message. I'm going to balance it before I even preach it. But how do I own this, what the writer of the Hebrews said, so great a salvation? How do I make that myself, for myself, take that for myself? The gospel gives us lofty promises in a lofty position, and it does. And we preach that stuff and teach that stuff all the time. This beautiful picture we illustrate on the wall, a masterpiece. But how do I take, it's just a picture. It could be a picture of a cupcake, a beautiful Rembrandt of a cupcake. Imagine that. You see the frosting just dripping off it, or maybe a Cinnabon. Something like that, something magnificent. But all it's a beautiful picture. You can look at that picture and say, that is beautiful, but I can't eat it. It's just paint. It's a picture. It's one dimensional. Sometimes I think that's the problem with the gospel. We look at the gospel, we see it's lofty, we see it's high, but we don't really access it. We don't know how to make it our own. Or there seems to be some missing pieces in our life that we take this gospel and it really doesn't have the impact on us or in us that we want it to have or we think that it should have. So maybe I can't, as I battle with, overcome my indwelt legalism. So then we go to the how-tos, and this is going to be a how-to message. How to love your husband when you don't even like him. And they give you 10 easy steps, or not so easy steps. And how do you change the way you feel? How do you overcome the things of your past? How do you overcome the things in your present? How do you do these things? And I have this thing in my notes that says, but how? How do I change the way that I feel? How do I walk in the Spirit? How do I stop fleshing out? How do I start being more like Christ and less like me? How does that all work? I understand we're justified, we're sanctified, we're adopted, we're regenerated, we got all the doctrines in our brains, but how does that work for me? How does it exercise an effectual power in our life that can actually begin to control how I live? Now, first of all, I want to discount, I'm discounting outgrowing sin. Some of us, if we just get too old, I say this a lot, to sin. We just like, I don't want to sin, it's too tiring. And so that's not spiritual growth. That's just getting old and getting tired. That's all that is. So that we're not, I'm talking about walking in the Spirit. and letting the Spirit actually transform our life. Now, this is when I do my commercial. I've got a little video clip for you I want to show you. Some of you might recognize the clip. I despise formulas. Formula Christianity. As you know, my degree is in counseling. I do a lot of counseling, and people will come in, and we deal with the but how question a lot. How do we make this work? And somebody has real life pain, real life loss. When we lost our daughter, I had all sorts of well-intentioned people giving me formulas on how to overcome and get over it. You don't get over it. You don't get over loss. You don't get over pain. You don't get over the loss of a family, the loss of a marriage. You live with it, but it's a real effectual woundedness takes place in our life. So to have a but how, this is how you do it. I don't like those formulas. I repel those formulas because I've heard them all. And it's our little religious way of making people religious. Life sometimes is devastating. You got to understand that. We as human beings, we were created to live in a perfect environment with a perfect God, with perfect health, with perfect people. That's what we were made for. The things that sin brought into the human race, called sin and all the effects of it, was not part of God's original plan. Death was not part of God's original plan. Life forever was. So with that said, I'm about to give you a formula. I told you I was discounting it, but let me show you this film clip. Some of you, this is a non-Christian film. We highly edited it because there's some non-Christian parts in it. But it's about 2.5 minutes long, and see if you remember this film clip. Go ahead.
Danielson! Danielson!
What?
Come here.
Can somebody get the back lights? Thank you, Laura.
Show me Sander Floor.
I can't move my arm, all right?
This is Karate Kid.
What are you doing? What are you doing?
Now show me Sander Floor.
How did you do that?
Shut up!
Sander Floor.
Stand up. Show me Sander Floor. Sander Floor. Sander Floor. Big sucker. Sander Floor. Sander Floor. Yes. Now show me wax on, wax off. Hey.
Wax on, wax off.
Wax on, wax off. Hey, wax on, hat. Wax off, hat. Concentrate. Look in my eye. Lock a hand. Thumb inside. Wax on, hat. Wax off, hat. Wax on, hat. Wax off, hat. Wax on. Wax off. Ush. Show me pentafence. Up, down. Up, down, up, down, other side, look eye, always look eye, show me penthouse, side, side, lock wrist, side, 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 yes, show me wax on, wax off, yes! Show me pentafence. Face! Face! Death! Death! Show me side to side. Death! 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 Show me sand of floor. Cut! Face! 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 Yush! I always look alive. Come back tomorrow.
You get what's happening there? Who's seen that movie, first of all? Something like you. If not, it's a great, it's an old movie. It's come from the 80s. Before that, the lead into that, we had to edit that part out because Danielson wasn't being very pleasant. And he was saying words that we wouldn't allow him to say here. But he was complaining because this guy was supposed to be teaching him karate. And all he was doing is painting the guy's house, sanding his deck, and waxing his car. And so he was teaching him, this is how you wax, this is how you sand the deck, this is how you paint. And what he was doing is drilling in him fundamental principles, so when they actually got into a karate competition, those motions would be not something you have to think about. They'd be secondary motions, they'd be reactions and responses, and not necessarily something that you'd have to even contemplate. So I say those things because there are some fundamental principles that we want to establish this morning in the next half hour or so that we have together, if not less. These things, if you want to enjoy the power of the gospel and walk in the Spirit and learning how to walk in the Spirit, then some of these things need to be in place at least most of the time. Now, they're simple things. This is not to say that you won't have weakness, failure, or any of those things. I'm just saying these are the core issues, those core movements that we need to have if we want to desire to be like Christ. Number one, do I have the same values as Jesus Christ? If I don't have the same values of Jesus Christ, I can't really expect the authority of the gospel and the power of the gospel to ever be unleashed in my life. If my life is not aligned with his life, then I really have no hope of experiencing anything that he offers me. So I say that again. If my life isn't aligned with his, if his priorities are not my priorities, if his values are not my values, if he sees life differently than I see life, if I'm trying to live in my lane and he's trying to pull me over to his lane and I ever make that lane switch, then that picture on the wall is just going to remain on the wall. This is a term we might want to coin as lordship. I don't believe in lordship salvation. That's not a doctrine I embrace, but I believe if I'm going to understand and enjoy the power of the gospel, then Jesus Christ needs to be the Lord of my life. He needs to have preeminence to the best of my understanding. And I understand there's a learning curve that goes on till we die. But having Christ in his preeminence in our life. Romans 8, 5 and 6 says this, Amplified Bible. I don't use this translation that much. For those who are living according to the flesh set their minds on things of the flesh, which gratify the body. But those who are living according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit, his will and purpose. Now the mind and the flesh is death, both now and forever, because it pursues sin. Now I'll just define sin there quickly. Singular, we've taught this many times, that word singular means the whole sin nature of man, the whole fallen nature of man, and that would include our flesh and everything else. Now pursue sin, but the mind of the Spirit is life and peace and the spiritual well-being that comes from walking with God both now and forever. So the principle is, if I'm going to experience the power of God, then I need to make sure my life, to the best of my understanding, is aligned with his life. If I'm here to just fulfill the American dream, or to have as much fun as I can between the cradle and the grave, and I don't really embrace God's purpose for my life, I can't expect the power of the gospel to be transformative in my life. So the first thing I say is, God, you are my Lord, my Savior, but now I give you governorship of my life. You're what I desire, what we sang. You're what I pant after. I want what you want. I want your priorities, your values. I want my life and how I want to see my marriage as you see my marriage. I want to see my money as you see my money. I want to see my time as you see my time. I want my priorities to line up with your priorities. Now we're being put in a place where we can be transformed and God's Spirit can really start working with us. Now, part of that, number two, are we willing to quiet our hearts, be humble and listen to man and or God? Sometimes I call it lawyer mode. We're too busy rebutting the argument. When we're listening to one argument, we're already rebutting that argument in our heads. We're thinking, okay, they're saying this, so I'm going to say this. And this happens in marriage counseling all the time. We don't ever really hear what the husband or the wife is saying. They don't hear each other. All they're doing is getting ready to rebut what the wife or the husband is saying so they can prove their point. So they never really listen. They never really quiet their hearts. Lamentations 3:26, it is good that a man should both hope and quietly wait. Quietly. Isaiah 26, verse 3, you will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is what? Stayed on thee, because he trusts in thee. So we quiet ourselves, and listen, this is a great rule of thumb to take. When somebody that loves you says something to you, not when they have a hatchet in the hand or anything like that. Just in a quiet moment, or they communicate to you what's going on in their life or somebody else's life, or it would behoove you to hear it. Number three, moving quickly, and this might be the most important of all. We must persevere. We spoke not too long ago about this. This isn't something that you'd find a lot of people writing about, even talking about, and this is certainly not popular today because we don't see perseverance necessarily as a great quality today, because we live in a culture that wants everything and they don't want to wait for it and they want it now. And we believe that we should not have any pain, economic pain or physical pain or emotional pain or relationship pain or anything like that. But my friends, all of life, the devil, his cohorts, the world system, which we talked about, I believe, last week, will all try to get you to quit. Whatever it is. Quit the faith, quit the marriage, quit the race. Webster's defines the words persevere. This is the exact cut and paste from his 1823 dictionary. It's a Latin word, per servo, so however you might say that. The last component part of the word servo must be the same as a servo, which that, you don't matter, but care about that. With the radical, here it is, the radical sense of set, fixed, or continued. So persist is formed with per and sisto, to stand. Constant and continue, like a primary sense. So we say to hold on, to persist in any business, or enterprise undertaken, to pursue steadily any design or course commenced, or not to give over or abandon what is undertaken, applied alike to both good and evil. Every natural inclination we have is to avoid pain. Run the other direction. Quit, medicate, whatever it is. Anything to get us to stop short of getting God's full intention for our life. I've been called to preach the gospel. I knew it since I was 19. I've had so many points in my life where I've just wanted to quit. I had a great dad. He was a great dad in the sense he taught it. He had this old New England work ethic, and they didn't quit for nothing. It's a blizzard outside. He said, go mow the lawn. All right, Dad. Thought the lawnmower was a snowblower or something. I don't know what he was thinking. But to get us to quit, to run, cut bait. Chambers says this: God takes his saints like a bow, which he stretches out at a certain point, and says, "I can't stand it anymore." But God doesn't take heed. He goes on stretching because he's aiming at his mark, not ours. And the patience of the saints is that they hang in until God lets the arrow fly. Know what he's saying there? God's stretching you out like a bow, and you're thinking, I can't take this. This is bigger than me. I can't take another failure. I can't take this loss. I can't take this pressure. I can't take this confusion. I can't take this grief. I can't take this pain. I can't walk with other people through their pain. The pain's so big for me, God, and you want me to walk other people through their pain. I can't do that. You need to come through. And God, here's the deadline. This is when you have to come through by. I've proven to God that he's been late so many times. And just when you think you can't take any more, you get stretched a little bit more, and you think, when's this going to end? I can't keep doing this. I can't take this. It's too hard, God. And then, because he knows exactly how much we can take, he lets the arrow fly. What did we do? We just simply persevered. Sometimes we have nothing but, that's the only thing we can do, is persevere. I've had times when, in the spiritual confusion of my life, I'm not even talking about loss of Hannah Grace, but I'm talking about other times when I had deadlines for God and economic deadlines, church stuff. I'd pray, I'd fast, I'd go away for 3 days and seek the Lord, and I had flooded with this peace and knew that God was with me and knew God that we're in the palm of God's hand, and I'm thinking to myself, I'm gonna come back and this problem's gonna be miraculously resolved, and that problem will be miraculously resolved, and that problem will be miraculously resolved, and I come back, none of it was resolved. But I knew God better. In fact, in some cases, the worst thing that I feared came to pass. And now I look back on some of those events, now 10 and 12 and 13 years ago, I realize God just stretched and stretched and stretched. Our culture, especially our younger culture, we have this sense that we're not supposed to go without or experience much hardship. That's very much an American thing. Just ask Christians across the world if they think that way. That's probably not the case. With 90,000 Christians being killed for their faith last year alone, the highest number in history, maybe. 90,000. God says, sorry. I'm not as much into your comfort as I am to transforming your character. If I could transform your character through a Sunday school booklet, I would do it. But I can't. Sometimes the only way I can transform your character is through pain and loss and failure. It's the only thing I can use. Education can't do it. More knowledge can't do it. Another sermon won't do it. It's just life. So don't quit. Just don't quit. Because God has a purpose intended. Fourth point, do I believe the finished work is really finished? Two more points, I'll have you out of here by 3. 2:45, I'll go soon. Do I believe the finished work is really finished? We talked about having our mind stayed on Christ earlier, and if my mind is stayed on my failure or my violation, how people have violated me, then my mind really isn't stayed on Christ. So I keep my mind stayed on him. See, I'm notorious at this. I'm preaching to myself. I'm notorious at unfinishing the finished work. I'm really good about giving people grace. I really see people for who they are. I don't judge people with their weaknesses or anything like that. I really don't judge many people. Sometimes I'll judge a Yankee fan, but that's just some. But outside of that, that's I think God judges them too. So but that's just me. That's an opinion. But when it comes to receiving grace for myself, I can give it. But giving it for myself, I unfinished the finished work all the time. Ezekiel, God's talking to Ezekiel about the nation of Israel, and they're saying, you know, Ezekiel, they love your words. They think it's a lovely song in Ezekiel chapter 33. I think it's 31, 32, 33 verse. Pretty. It's pretty. They hear your words, but they don't do it. We hear about the finished work, but do we really believe that the finished work is absolutely a finished work and how that applies to our life? Let me read you these verses, and then we'll get on to the last point. And you know this passage, but let's just read them for ourselves. This is how God thinks about you. This is how he approaches the gospel in your life. What then shall we say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? Thank you, Kerry. Anyone else want to join Kerry? If God be for us, who can be against us? Thank you. Who did God not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all? How will he not also with him graciously give us what? All things. Who, again, I love the question, who? Like God saying, Paul saying, who? Tell me, who? Who will bring anything to charge against God's elect? It is God that what? I don't justify myself. God justifies me. Who is it to condemn? Christ is the one who died. More than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. Who can separate us from what? The love of Christ. So tribulation, distress, persecution, famine, nakedness, danger, sword, it's written. For your sake we are being killed all the day long, and we are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through Christ who loves us. That word conquerors is the word Nikeo, where we get the word Nike from, the sneaker, Nike. That word means victory in the original language. That's a Greek word. But this word, more than conquerors, has a prefix, hupo on it, H-U-P-O, and nikeo, huponikeo, which means it's beyond victorious. In other words, it talks about a victory that we don't have to fight the battle for. It's a victory that was won for us. It's not my victory, it's Christ's victory. I'm just the recipient of his victory. We're more than conquerors through him that has us on trial. Who what? Loved us. For I'm sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things to come, nor powers present, or things to come, nor powers, he's talking about every demon under the earth and every demon in hell, nor height, nor depth, nor anything in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. You believe that?
Yes.
Rehearse it. Memorize those puppies. To hide them deep in your heart. And believe that to be true for yourself. It'll change how you walk. It'll change how you see yourself. It'll change how you see others. It'll change how you see the world. Romans 6:14 says, for sin shall not have dominion over me, that sin nature. For you are not under the law, but what? Under grace. We're going to be speaking a message on that in about 2 weeks. These promises, my friends, must be true, or we have no hope. They're not past promises. They're not future promises. They're present promises, as long as past and future. They're eternal promises. The gospel needs to be my starting point and my ending point for my edification, my affirmation, my love and acceptance. You fill in the blank. Last point, this is more practical. Do I practice a regular time with Jesus Christ? in the five love languages that Chapman put out, one of the five love languages is quality time. That's one of my wife's love languages. I don't have quality time. I don't care if you spend time with me. I'm just assumed as, I don't know why I'm like that. I don't need quality time. But my wife needs quality time. See, quality time to me is I can sit there and next to her on a couch and watch TV. This is quality, right? It's Fox News. It's sort of quality. It's a Christian movie. That's quality. That wasn't quality time to her. She actually wanted me to talk to her.
You're kidding.
That's quality time? Yeah. She wanted me to actually talk with her. And then, she not only did she want me to talk with her, don't tell her I'm saying this. keep this just between us. Not only did she want me to talk to her, she wanted me to pay attention to what she was saying back. What'd she expect from me anyway? I mean, she was, and I would just, so I would have to listen. Okay, but you know, this is the talking points. This is the best part. Can she be sharing her heart with me? And pause it. What? Oh no, what? What do you mean, honey? I just and so she would see, that's her love language. She wants to actually engage with me and talk with me and converse with me and me actually listen to what she's saying when I'm not multitasking in her mind, which isn't really multitasking, I'm just zoning out. But it's that's what she really wants. So if I want to know my wife, I didn't have any trouble with this when I was dating her. Because we'd just sit and we'd go out to dinner and we'd talk all day long and it was great. But 30 years later, this is my wife and this is Bill O'Reilly. You know, my wife will be there and Bill O'Reilly's off. So I could actually just talk with Bill O'Reilly now or just listen to Bill O'Reilly. And my wife is like, and no. It's never good enough. Of course, I'm making fun. The principle is, if I want a relationship with somebody, I spend time with them. I converse with them. I find out what's going on in their life. I communicate what's going on in my life. 1 Corinthians 9:25 through 27 says, all athletes are disciplined in their training. They do it to win a prize that will fade away, but we do it to win an eternal prize. So I run with purpose in every step. I'm not just shadow boxing. And watch what he says here. This is, I think, an important verse for us in our desire to be like Christ. I discipline my body like an athlete, training to do what it should. Otherwise, I fear that after preaching to others, I myself might be disqualified. He won't finish his race well, is what he's saying. So he's saying, what Paul's saying, I say no to myself. I say no to my preferences. I say no to what I want to do. I say no to my scheduling choices. I say no, maybe I say no to how long I sleep or what time I get out of bed. Maybe I have to say no to what I consume as food in my physical body so I have better health. But I learn to say no to myself. No, I need to get up and spend time with God. No, I need to eat better. I have disciplined myself. I need to do these things. And this is what Paul is saying here. I discipline my body like an athlete. I've learned this in my own life and have to discipline my own body. I mean, some of you know my health issues. High cholesterol, high blood pressure, everything. I had pizza last night. I really did. It was amazing. It's my second pizza since July. Then I'll get up and I exercise and I do this and I showed Andre my vitamin closet. I might just call me Kelley's vitamin shop. Take every pill that you can imagine. I go to the doctors, my blood pressure's high. I swore. No, I didn't. I was like, how does this high? I do everything. I exercise 5 days a week, 6 days a week. I take fistfuls of nutrition. I eat lettuce. I eat like a rabbit. How's my blood pressure high? You know, just blame it on your parents. So I did. It's their fault. Everything I've screwed up in my life is their fault. My point is, I needed to get to a certain thing. I have to sometimes bring myself under discipline. Same way spiritually, my friends. This isn't a formula. It's nothing like that. But I want to know God. Really, an hour and a half on a Sunday morning is not enough. It's just not enough. If I really want to know God, I can't expect to leave here and say, okay, I'm on Christian highway for the rest of my week till next Sunday. I'll stay on the highway. No, I need to meet God tomorrow and Tuesday and Wednesday and Thursday and Friday and Saturday. If I want this gospel to be mine, if I want it to impact my life day by day, if I want to understand what it means to walk in the Spirit, then I learn to meet God. It's not a formula. It's a fellowship. You don't have to read 10 chapters a day. You can read 2 verses a day. You read a few devotionals, sing some psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Think about it. Put a few verses in your pocket and just reiterate them throughout the day. Whatever, however you do it between you and the Lord, however it works for you. But do it. And if you've never had that discipline, then you bring your body under the, whatever that means. Whether it's going to bed a little earlier and getting up a little earlier. Whatever that means. To spend time with Jesus Christ, because there's a river of flowing water that he wants you to dip into. And this is how it works. It's not something you fix when you're 22 years old, then you fix for the rest of your life. You fix it every day. You get up and you meet God and he fixes you, and you get up and you meet God again and he fixes you, and you get up and you meet God and he fixes you, and he keeps making you more and more like him. And this process goes on till we finally don't have to go through the process anymore. We're in heaven. But if I don't spend quality time with him, I can't expect to have an intimate relationship with him. I truly can't. That's not legalism, that's just practicality. What quality time means to you and what it means to me could be very different things, but neither here nor there, the hand of relationship is extended from Jesus Christ to every one of his children. We have a living word of God in Hebrews 4:12. He extends his hand and says, will you come to know me? I'm not talking about for salvation. I'm talking about for intimacy and fellowship. And worship and praise. Will you come to know me? If we would just do this one thing and settle our hearts and spend time with Jesus Christ in the Spirit, you'd find that the stuff at home, the stuff in here, the stuff up here, all of a sudden starts working its way out. I'm not saying the pain isn't real, it is. I'm not saying the confusion isn't real. It probably is very real. I'm not saying the questions are not legitimate. They're legitimate questions you may have. But you find that you have the grace and the strength and the ability to go on one more day, then one more day after that, then one more day after that. Jesus, thank you for these words and thank you for the precious people. Hard message in a sense to understand in some ways, and the implementation of it so different for all of us. With every head bowed and every eye closed, as we do every service here at Grace Connection, if you're here and have never asked Jesus Christ to be your Savior, in the quiet place of your heart, between you and God, say this simple prayer after me. Dear Jesus, thank you for dying on the cross for me. Thank you for shedding your blood for me. Today is my day of eternal life. 26th day of February, 2017. I'm asking you to be my Savior. I have a physical birthday, and I want today to be my spiritual birthday. Lord, I have questions. And you know I do. But today I'm simply believing you for my eternal life. With every head bowed, if you in your own way, in your own words, you said yes to Christ, let the person that brought you here, let them know so they can just help you and instruct you and encourage you, or let us know and we can do that. Father, teach me to take this message and We don't want it to be a how-to message, God. We want it to be maybe inspiration, encouragement, to not to quit, to maybe realign our values with you. Maybe we've allowed our schedule to be our Lord. Maybe we've allowed our money to be our Lord. Maybe we've allowed our children to be our God. I don't know, God, whatever it is, help us realign ourselves with you in those areas which we've let go. Father, give me the courage to persevere when I want to quit. Just give me the courage. Bring people into my life to encourage me when I want to quit. Help me embrace this gospel, understand it, see the glory of it, see the scope of it and the magnitude of it. God, help me appreciate this gospel. And Father, help me to take my body and bring it under subjection, as your word says, to train myself to spend time with you every day. Father, meet me in the mornings, meet me in the afternoons, meet me in the evenings. Be real to me like never before. Bless the offering we're about to share as part of our worship today. In Jesus' name, amen.